welcome Slash.
We saw in the clip here, the last clip from your new album, we saw you and Fergie from Black Eyed Peas.
Yeah.
What were you doing there?
What was I doing there?
She was putting something in your drink, I think.
Yeah, she plays an obsessed stalker fan, and she's trying to lure me into her hotel room. So she puts a little Mickey in my cocktail, and drugs me out so she can get me into the car and takes me back to the thing.
I see.
That's the premise.
I see, okay. then I have to ask you, how are you these days?
Good.
Because I read a few years ago that you had a major heart trouble.
Well, I had a alcohol poisoning, and so I had a cardiomyopathy, which is when your heart enlarges and your it doesn't beat as strongly as it's supposed to. And so they gave me what do you call it? Sort of pacemaker, defibrillator.
Uh-huh, I see.
And so that'll, you know, hopefully keep you alive, you know? And you know, because they told me you only had like 6 weeks to live at best at that time.
So you quit smoking and drinking then?
I did.
That was very wise of you.
I survived it, but I've been, that was in 2001, so I just got completely clean like 4.5 years ago.
So now we're well on the
How does this machine work? Does it like...
If you're, you know the defibrillator they put on you where they pump your chest?
Yeah.
It's like that only from the inside. So if your heart starts beating too fast or too slow, it kicks it back into its normal rhythm.
And has it done that yet or is it, I mean...
No, because, yeah. It hasn't done it. It did it when I first got it because I forgot to tell the doctor that when I go on stage, my heartbeat goes way up. And so I went and did some shows with Michael Jackson and was on stage and all of a sudden this thing kicked in. It was like getting hit with a baseball bat, you know, without the pain, but the impact of it. And I was like, what the hell was that? but it did it like 5 times.
But what happens if, let's say, if the battery goes out or something, do you then die or can you still live on your own heart?
No, I mean, basically it's there to protect you if your heart goes out of rhythm.
Okay.
So if the battery goes out and your heart's okay. It'll be fine. Yeah.
When I read the book about you, it's like you took pills like it was candy, you know, or drugs like it was candy. And I wonder how could you play the guitar so amazingly when you did that?
That's a good question. I don't know. It was just something that I was just sort of good at doing. You know, it was a great balancing act. You know, I was a little bit more responsible than I probably appeared. I was very aware of how much I was doing. But there would be moments when, you know, this particular thing was with alcohol. And it was just, I'd been drinking so much for so long that it finally had to affect something, and it just turned out to be my heart. But I played fine. You know?
When did you start with drugs? Did you start earlier?
I was probably like 13.
13?
Yeah. Because it was... Mm. You know, I was one of those sort of rebellious kids that was getting into everything. Yeah.
And how old are you now?
45.
45.
And still here.
And still here.
and you actually grew up in a sort of rock and roll environment. I mean, you're originally British.
Originally, yeah.
And
I'm still half
British. You're still British. Yeah. And your mother, I understand, was really a big time designer, doing clothes for John Lennon, Yoko Ono, David Bowie.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah, it's great. Yeah. She both my mom and my dad, she did the clothing. Designing for really a lot of the big entertainers of the 70s. And my dad was doing album covers. So we were in that sort of entertainment circle, you know, which everything, especially in the 70s, there was a lot of drugs, a lot of sex, a lot of stuff. And, you know, I just naturally fell into that kind of lifestyle.
Is it true that she actually dated David Bowie for a while?
She did, yeah.
So did she bring him home?
Yeah. He was sort of like, you know, I guess for want of a better word, sort of like my stepdad for a period there, you know.
Doesn't seem natural to call him dad.
No, I mean, you know. But I mean, he was the first man to come along and sort of take the place of my dad in the household. So it was an interesting...
Incredible. You know, what period of Bowie's was this?
This was his Thin White Duke period.
Incredible, yeah. Having the Thin White Duke home as your...
And the thing was, is she was... My mom was making clothes for him and designing his clothes. But, I mean, I got used to him pretty easily. He was a good guy, you know. He's a very mild-mannered, very soft-spoken, creative individual.
Can I ask you something totally different? Mm-hmm. Are you always wearing the hat and the sunglasses?
A lot.
Just curious.
Yeah. I mean, in sort of public situations like this, it's, yeah.
She always have...
I always have my hair, so that's the reason I asked.
It's one of those things I feel more comfortable.
Is it the kind of image? Yeah. But you use the hat and
yeah,
the
but
glasses.
It's more of a comfort zone for me because I'm basically pretty shy. And if I was out here without the shades and without a guitar and without the
how
hat,
how can you
I'd
be shy? We saw the clip. I mean, you're dancing around the stage and playing the guitar fantastically and doing all these things.
But that's
and you're
different because, yeah, as a performer and with a guitar, I feel a lot more comfortable than without.
So that it's safe to hold the guitar. That's, you know, then you're safe when you have it.
Yeah.
So and if you take off your hat and the glasses, no one will recognize you.
Well, that's not really the whole thing of it, though.
Isn't it?
I mean, all things considered, I think it's something that people have started to recognize me like that because I always wear it.
If anything, what do you miss from the Guns N' Roses years?
I don't know. I don't really miss anything because I had such a full experience doing it. And really took it to as far as one could take it and still have a good time. So that was all, you know, that was really, it's not something I miss because I did it. And when I moved on, I was pretty satisfied with where it ended.
And you got to work with a lot of other musicians as well, among them Michael Jackson, as you mentioned.
Right.
Could you relate to him as a person?
Yeah, as an artist, for sure. I mean, our relationship was purely, you know, professional. I didn't go over to the house and hang out and all that kind of stuff. But on a professional level, we got along great. And I really liked him as a person on that level, you know?
I also have to ask you about one of your, I think he's one of your neighbors in LA, Robbie Williams.
Right.
Because he's coming on this show in a few weeks.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
And how is he as a neighbor?
He's great. You know, I go over there and, I mean, you know, he's a good guy. Play poker over there and stuff.
You play is he a poker player?
He's a good poker player.
Really?
Yeah.
He doesn't have much of a poker face. He wouldn't...
Actually, he's got a great poker face. It's hard to explain. He's just acting himself while he's kicking your ass in poker. He doesn't look like he's trying very hard, and he talks a lot to other people while he's doing it. And actually, the way I met Robbie Williams, I was in the courtyard of a hotel in Hollywood. And this guy, which I didn't know who Robbie Williams was. You know, in the States, he's not as popular as he is in Europe. And so this guy comes up to me and goes, "Hey, you're from Stoke." And I was like, "Yeah, you know," and I said, "You know, yeah, I'm from Stoke." And I said, he goes, "I'm from Stoke." And I was like, "That's great," you know. I mean, I wasn't really interested in this conversation. And he goes, I'm Robbie Williams." And I was like, "Okay." Anyway, so then later that night, I went to do a guest spot with some musicians called Camp Freddy, which is a core band that have all these different celebrity musicians get up and jam. Mm-hmm. And so I got up there to start playing, and the guy who was singing was Robbie Williams.
Incredible. Yeah. I mean, you're both from Stoke. I mean, they must be very proud of you in Stoke.
I haven't been back there, but my family is proud. You know, I talk to them all the time, and I see them when they come out to visit at shows and so on. But I actually haven't been back to Stoke in 40 years.
Well, probably you have a statue there or something.
Well, they want to build a statue.
They want to build a statue.
Yeah. So I plan on going back there at some point next year and during the UK tour and actually doing a show in Stoke if I can. Because apparently they have a great venue that we can play.
And they will have a statue there.
I don't know. I think they're lobbying to have a statue. You know, I don't know if...
One of Robbie as well, then?
I don't know. I know that they want to build one of me and they want to build one of Lemmy from Motorhead.
But not Robbie?
I don't know. I haven't heard about Robbie.
This might be an issue, you know. I'll certainly discuss this with him. Please welcome John Nettles.